Okay, thank you, Emil. The talk has quite a long title. However, you will see during the talk that it mostly says everything I'm going to talk about today. The most important part of this work and the most creative part of this work was done by Avraham Klein in Hebrew University, who is a student of Aded Agam. And we published quite a long paper and all the details in 2014. And everything which I'm going to say is based on the result of that paper. So this is what I'm going to do today. The first, I will try to formulate the problem of the moving of the vortices moving in two-dimensional superfluid and formulate the notion of the dipole moment of the moving vortex, and then formulate the result, which was quite unexpected, at least for us, which will be about non-analytic dependence of the dipole moment on the velocity of the vortex. Then I will have to spend some time describing the formalism at which we studied the motion of the quantum vortices in the superfluid. And this is known as Popov's hydrodynamics, and I will remind you what it is and how to work with it. Then I will switch to our results, which is the solution of the moving vortex in Popov's formalism. And there will be first the numerical solution, which is due to Avraham Klein. Then there will be some analytic interpretation and the connection to so-called weak solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equations. And then I will derive the answer for the dipole moment of the vortex, which I will formulate in the first part. And then I will discuss the physical quantities, which will be low frequency cyclotron dynamics of the quantum vortex. And we will talk how it comes about, why those excitations are long-lived, which brings me to the point of the interaction of the vortex with phonons, which will be the problem of scatterings of the phonons and the radiation. And then I will conclude with the quantization of the vortex motion and will show the new low energy degrees of freedom, which will appear due to the physics I will discuss over here. So basically, I will start with a very simple problem with which we start teaching our students about superfluid hydrodynamics. I will talk about the vortex, the quantum vortex in local hydrodynamics. And basically what you do, you introduce two fields. One field is the velocity, and the other field is the particle density. Then the first equation which you write has nothing to do with the superfluidity. TT in the stationary case is just a continuity equation. The second equation, it's already quantum. It replaces the Kelvin theorem in the classical hydrodynamics. And basically, the statement is that the vorticity is quantized, and the statement goes back to Anzager in 1949. So this equation is classical. This is the equation which is quantum. As a matter of fact, you can see that you can quite easily get rid of all the constants, just measure R in units of the Hilling lengths, which I will introduce later on. But for starters, it just has a meaning of the size of the vortex core. And velocity in then has a natural units, h bar over mxi, or one can quite easily realize that it's nothing but the sound velocity in the superfluid. And if you do this, then those equations become dimensionless, and you have to close the system, and you are closing the system due to Bernoulli equation. And once again, there is nothing quantum in the Bernoulli equation, and in the proper units, it just has the simple form. So then you can quite easily solve the first equation. It has an obvious form in the complex notation. like so. Then you put it into the Bernoulli equation. Then it, at the large distances, it's one. Then, of course, it's down near the vortex as the algebraic function because it's v squared over 2. And of course, this formula is correct only at z larger than 1. And then the local hydrodynamics become inapplicable, and you have to solve something else, which we will talk about later on. But z equals to 1, you can basically find the definition of the Hilling lines from here. This is the distance at which the density drops by a factor of 2. And then you have to check the last equation, which is a continuity equation, and you quite easily see that it goes through. Just you see that the real part is here. You differentiate it with respect to z. Therefore, the derivative is coming only from here. So the continuity equation goes through, and you are done with the vortex, and you are done with the motionless vortex in terms of the local hydrodynamics. So everything is consistent. The problem begins if you start considering a little bit more complicated problem, which is the following. You just fix the vortex. You just fix the vortex at the position equals to 0 and put the boundary condition that you have a superfluid velocity, that equals to constant, at the distance going to infinity. And of course, by the virtue of the Galilean invariance, you can ask the problem of the vortex, which is moving with the velocity minus Vs, with respect to superfluid. Very well, let us try to do the same thing. You have the same equation, but the initial condition changes, but in principle you can try superposition. So that's what I do. Once again, you have to go through the Bernoulli equation. It doesn't change, so it's like this. You have to put this velocity, take the modulus squared, and then you try to go through the continuity equation, and you see that due to the fact that here you have v squared and you have a product of constant and z star, then as a matter of fact, the continuity equation doesn't work due to the fact that the liquid is compressible. If the liquid were non-compressible, it would work very well, but here you already have a problem. So, and you can try to resolve this problem using the iteration, which is quite easy thing to do, and you get the first correction, which looked like this. And as you see, this combination has the meaning of the additional flow, which is created by the dipole, which I will denote by the letter D, and you can find the expression for this dipole moment, and the first term is proportional to the logarithm of z, and this is a deformation in the distances larger than the Hilling lengths, but it also contains some unknown constant, which I will call the dipole moment on the Hilling lengths. Now, looking at this formula, and basically this is not that it's something extremely new. People knew this for many years. The point was always that this comes from the vortex cost deformation. Therefore, it cannot contain any large factors. Therefore, whatever calculation of the vortex cost deformation you are doing, it's basically just change the factor in front of the logarithm, and then there is practically nothing to study. The point which I'm going to make that it's not really so, and the result is, and I forgot to mention that why this dipole moment is important. It's important that if you start thinking about the vortex mass, you immediately realize that if you think about the vortex as a point particle and then think about the superfluid, and the superfluid is something which you move together with the vortex, you know from the course of hydrodynamics that the added mass to the body is proportional to the dipole moment of the superfluid. So as a matter of fact, the problem about that dipole moment is the problem about the effective mass of the vortex. So anyway, but the point of our paper and the point of what I'm going to talk about during the remaining time is that this dipole moment, as a matter of fact, is not the simple analytic function. function which determines the cutoff of the logarithm. As a matter of fact, it's a function by itself, which extremely non-analytic in terms of the velocity. So as a matter of fact, what I am going to talk about that the deformation of the vortex core, as a matter of fact, doesn't have a Taylor expansion. Now, before I start presenting the detail theory and the numerics, I have to talk to you which equation we actually use in order to describe the vortex system. The Gross-Pitayevsky equation is not extremely suitable. I will explain later on. And we used what is known as Popov's hydrodynamics for two-dimensional Bose gas. This is in the textbook in chapter 621. So, and basically the story is the following. You start with the Gross-Pitayevsky action. And in two dimension, it's just standard bosonic action, and the energy has a form of the nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Then you realize, and lambda is the dimensionless interaction strength, then you realize that, as a matter of fact, if you change the units, measure the distance in terms of the healing lengths, measure time in terms of the inverse healing energy, measure psi squared in terms of n naught, and just define that the healing length times the density is 1 over lambda, which is basically the large parameter of the theory, you realize that, as a matter of fact, all the action doesn't contain any constants anymore, and lambda plays the role of the effective Planck constant, so that if the interaction action strength is small, then the semiclassics for the section is perfectly justified. Now, the problem is that at the large distance, this term is much more important than this one. Therefore, to work with this term in terms of the perturbation theory is not convenient and it's not practical. And once again, what is known as a Madelung transformation. It's all standard, and what you obtain from here is the expression in terms of the density and three-dimensional velocities, and each component of the velocity is determined by either time derivative of the phase or the coordinate derivative of the phase, and it's all quite standard. The problem is that, as everybody knows, that theta is a multivalued function of x, which means that any jumps by the any integer factor of 2 pi on any semiplane is allowed. Therefore, if you would like to consider the vortices, you will have to introduce the lines, then you have to introduce in two plus one space the semiplanes which goes to infinity and allow jumps by the factor of 2 pi, and if you would like to consider the vortices, you have to be able to consider the moving of the boundary as a function of space, and this is quite a cumbersome thing to do. And the idea of Popov is basically the following: that you trade the velocity field to some auxiliary field using the following recipe. You basically say that I have three components of the velocities, and just let treats, and if they were independent, it would be the Gaussian theory, so in principle you can integrate over V. However, as a matter of fact, the three-dimensional curl of the velocity, city in the absence of the vortices is zero because it's gradient, three-dimensional gradient of the function of theta. And in the place where you have a vortex line, it's determined by the vortex density current, which I define like so. This is the expression for the simple vortex density, which basically shows that it's just a delta function which moves according to this function r of t, and this is the vortex velocity, which is nothing but the vortex density, since you multiply by the vortex velocity. And of course, by construction, the vortex current is conserved, and it means that similar to the motion of the particles in the classical electrodynamics, you can introduce the gauge theory. And this basically what was done. And this basically what was done by Popov. So what you are doing, you put this constraint as an integration of the auxiliary gauge field with three components. This is a scalar potential. Those two components of the vector potential. You have a function which is linear in V naught and the quadratic in V, so you can calculate the functional integral, and this is a Popov action. Basically, it contains two parts. First part is precisely what you have in classical electrodynamics. This is the vortex current, which is equivalent to the particle current, multiplied by the vector scalar potential A. And even though here you have explicitly the vector potential, the theory is still gauge invariant because the vorticity is conserved. And this part basically includes all the phonons. It includes Bogalyubov quasi-particles, it creates phonon-phonon interaction, it contains everything you can think of. And you see that if you put B equals to 1 over here, and you forget about this term, and you just count B from 1, then you restore E squared minus B squared over 2, which would be linear electrodynamics. Now, here it's nonlinear hydrodynamics, and it's nonlinear hydrodynamics for the reason that, as a matter of fact, this E squared over 2B is a combination which is protected by nothing but the Galilean invariance, which I will show later on. Now, if you would like to go back and try to establish the vocabulary, the dictionary between old variables and new variables, then you see that the effective magnetic field is nothing but the density, of the particles, and the current is nothing but the electric field rotated by the 90 degrees. This is more or less Galilean invariance, and as I said, the form of this term is protected, and here you can write in principle whatever you want because under Galilean invariance B doesn't change. We have an action. And therefore, you can write an equation of motion which will be equivalent to the Maxwell equation. The first Maxwell equation follows from the connection between the gauge fields and the physical fields E and B. And if you think about meaning of B and meaning of the electric field, this is nothing but the continuity equation which is written in a new variable. Now, the second Maxwell equation, which used to be divergence of E equals to density, becomes divergence of E over B equals to the vortex density, and this would replace the quantization of the vorticity. And it's once again much easier to think about than original equation. And the third Maxwell equation looks a little bit terrible. However, if you forget about those nonlinear terms, this becomes just a regular Maxwell equation, right? Now, this term is once again needed for the Galilean invariance, and this term is something which defines the physics in the vortex core. And once again, this term and this term together, they are fixed, and they, the necessity of this combination follows from the vorticity conservation. Now, as a matter of fact, Popov equations allow you to extract something more, which in the Gross-Pitayevsky is kind of obscure, namely to immediately calculate the force acting on vortex, and this is quite easy. You just vary this term with respect to the position of the vortex, and you find that force actually consists of electric, of the force due to the electric field, and the Lorentz force, and as a matter of fact, it's nothing but the Magnus force, and moreover, you can check that this is a Galilean invariant quantity, as it should be. Okay, So Popov's equations are nonlinear, and as a matter of fact, the disentangling of self-interaction is non-trivial, and I will talk about this issue later on. Okay. Finally, to complete the picture of the Popov description, let me comment about the relation of the Popov's equation and Gross-Pitayevsky equation. This is the Gross-Pitayevsky equation, which is nonlinear Schrödinger equation. So the Popov equations, you can basically just check that if you put B equals to psi squared and E equals to the current rotated by 90 degrees, then those quantities go through, provided that the coordinates is not coinciding with the position of the vortex, and psi squared not equals to zero. Otherwise, in the region where psi squared equals to zero, the Gross-Pitayevsky and Popov's equations are different, and we will see later that, as a matter of fact, it's important. So now this is about Popov's story, which was done quite a while ago, and he didn't get too much out of this. So what I'm going to do now is basically come back to the story I told you in the very beginning about the dipole moment, and to talk about how this dipole moment appears within Popov's formalism. So the first question is, of course, just isolated vortex to make sure that everything is correct as it should be. So you basically take the second Maxwell equation, Schön solution is quite obvious. Then you put it back into the third Maxwell equation, and you see that B which you are getting from this equation is rotationally invariant. And then you check that as a matter of fact, it immediately goes through the first Maxwell equation that curl E indeed identically equals to zero. Therefore, this equation is the one which you have to solve, and you can change the variables and just to make sure that you obtained the result which first was obtained by Gisburg-Pitayevsky in 1958. And the only thing which I will need from those equations is that at the small distances, the density goes down as the second power of the coordinate with some constant which will play the role. And what I'm going to construct further. Okay, then let us do a little bit more complicated thing. Then let us fix the vortex. And in Popov's formalism, you can do it quite easily, unlike in Gross-Pitayevsky. And once again put the condition of the finite superfluid flow at large distances. This is curl of E equals to zero, so you can parameterize it by the scalar potential and get a set of the coupled equations. And those set of the couple equations were solved numerically by Avraham Klein in 2012, 2013. And also something was done by Vadim Chyanov. And the numerical result, which I'm going to present you first, is basically the color plot of the density, the color plot of the density as a function of the coordinates. So superfluid velocity looks in this direction. So the Magnus force director perpendicular, as it should be. Well, and the distribution of the density. And in the first glance, you can see nothing, right? Just density, vanishes somewhere, and it's a little bit not cylindrically symmetric, which indication of the dipole point, otherwise nothing spectacular. However, if you blow up a little bit, you see that something already going on, and if you actually try to measure the density, as a matter of fact, what you immediately figure out is that immediately after the velocity equals to zero, the region where density equals to zero is not a point anymore, as it used to be for the motionless vortex, that as a matter of fact, you immediately have the line where density of the particle, where density of the particles equals to zero identically. So if you wish, what the conclusion is that immediately after you start moving vortex with respect to the superfluid with the finite velocity, you get line of zeros, which also can be sought as a sequence of the vortex anti-vortex pairs, which are just close together, similar to the Schwinger mechanism. So this is just a little bit more information. This is just a density city as a function of the coordinate along this direction, and this is a density as a function of the coordinate along that direction. Red dots are the numerical data. The black line is a theoretical formula, which I will show you later on. Okay, this is a distribution of currents. You basically see that there is a region, there is a line of the zero density, and the current, of course, doesn't go through this line. Now, and the final piece of the numerical data, which you should know, is that if you just find the numerically the length of the cut as a function of the superfluid velocity, you can see that more or less it follows the straight line. What? If you have a question, ask me. I know better, I think. So basically after I presented numerical data, I will try to explain why do we need the cut as a matter of fact, as a matter of principle, and why the moving vortex, as a matter of fact, is not compatible to the strong solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. And then the second question, which I will try to answer, is how to describe the solution near the cut and how to reconcile the analytics with numerics. So let's suppose that I have a Gross-Pitayevsky equation, and far from the core, the solution for the moving vortex, once again, is just a phase which has to satisfy superposition principle. This is the phase of the vortex, and this is the phase which corresponds to the superfluid velocity. At the distances, at some intermediate distances, you can expand it, right? And then basically what it looks like is just a Bogolyubov expansion of the Gross-Pitayevsky nonlinear equation, which I will write like this. And then those are just a stationary Bogolyubov equations, which you are supposed to solve with the boundary condition that functions u and v should look like this. So, and this Bogolyubov equations, as a matter of fact, you can solve quite easily. The first solution is kind of obvious, and it works independently on the density in the vortex, and this is just a translational invariance that if you shift the vortex, it will still be the solution, right? So this is what you do, and this is the exact solution of the gross, and this is the exact solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. The second solution you can find quite easily because there is a Wronskian which equals to constant, and and of course this solution has nothing to do with the solution we are looking for because it's asymptotic behavior, it's 1 over r, and we are looking for r. Now, here is the second solution, and you see that it has a correct asymptotics at the large distances of r. However, if you go with the distances smaller than the healing lengths, what you find immediately is that, as a matter of fact, it's logarithmically divergent no matter what you do, which means that if you would like to stick with the solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation in all area of the space, you immediately figure out that you have to throw away the divergent solution, which means that solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equations corresponding to the vortex moving with respect to the superfluid simply doesn't exist. And I believe this conclusion was first noticed by Taulis and Engler. Then, as a matter of fact, what we saw numerically is that you have to allow for so-called weak solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. What it means is basically the following, that you allow Gross-Pitayevsky equations to be violated in the set of measure zero, which is a straight line, which in this particular case is a straight line. And you can figure out immediately that the action is finite, so action doesn't diverge. So this equation realizes, as a matter of fact, the minimum of the Gross-Pitayevsky action in some extended sense that you are allowing for the weak solution. And if you do so, then you can solve all the problems quite easily, because in the vicinity of the core, Gross-Pitayevsky equation is nothing but the Laplace equation. You introduce the cut and put the condition that the density on the cut equals to zero. Well, if you have a cut, you can do Joukowsky transformation, of course, and find the solution. And basically make a conformal transformation of the cut onto the strip, and look for the analytic function satisfying by the onto the boundary condition, and the only function which you can possibly write is what is written here, and you cannot write anything else. And you look at the asymptotic behavior, and you immediately find the expression for the width of the cut in terms of the superfluid velocity, and you see that the length of the cut is proportional to the superfluid velocity with the constant alpha squared, which is nothing but the constant in the Gibbs-Pitayevsky solution for the isolated vortex at VC equals to zero. Now, it requires some work to calculate the phases and to figure out that, as a matter of fact, that vortex is located here, meaning that if you take this integral around this contour, you will take the proper 2 pi, and if you take this integral of any combination around this contour, you will get zero, but it's quite easy to do, but I will not have time to explain it in details. So, once again, this is numerics versus analytics. This is length of the cut multiplied by this value alpha squared, which has to be the straight line, which is shown by the black line. Those dots are numerics. This black line is an analytic formula, and you can see that whatever numerics we can do we are within the limit. Now, this is those are numerical data for the density. Those are analytic formulas which I showed you before. And once again, you can see that it is as good as you can get. Okay. So anomalous dipole moment. You have an asymptotic behavior corresponding to the weak solution. You have a Bogoliubov expansion. You can match this one with this one in any distances which you like, you can get, and you can get basically the dipole moment expansion which I promised you in the very beginning, which corresponds to the local hydrodynamics, and the expression for the expression for the dipole moment follows from here, and this is the formula which I shown to you in the very beginning. So the first intermediate conclusion is that for the moving for the vortex moving for the superfluid moving with respect to the motionless vortex, there appears the anomalous dipole moment, which doesn't have a Taylor expansion in terms of the velocity of Vs. And this is not a consequence of the large distance, it's a consequence of the distances smaller than the Hilling lines, and it corresponds to the non-analytic reconstruction of the vortex core, which corresponds to the weak solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. Now, strong solution of the Gross-Pitayevsky equation, as I said, doesn't exist. Now, you can improve this formula a little bit by immediately noticing that you can play the Galilean invariants. The dipole moment has to be Galilean invariants. So instead of the superfluid velocity, what you have is just nothing but the force which acts on the vortex, which is the total Magnus force. Okay, now I explained to you how the thing appear. The last part of the talk, and I believe Ada Tagam will continue, is why should we care? And as a matter of fact, we should. So what I'm going to do is to start to derive the effective low energy theory, meaning that I would like to consider distances much larger than the Hilling lengths and the frequencies much smaller than the Hilling energy. And basically what I will try to do is to take full flash Popov action and reduce it to the low energy action. Now, if there are no vortices, this is Popov. And of course, if you go at the large distances, what you can drop immediately is this gradient terms. This is gradient term, and you end up with the action, which is still nonlinear. And it's nonlinear for the reason because the Galilean invariance doesn't care at which distances you are. Now, let's consider dilute vortices. In the original theory, there were the points which we moving with the same velocity. Of course, you would like to keep them as a point, but you cannot because you got rid of those derivatives over here, which means that if you keep the vortex as a point, the solution will be badly divergent. So as a matter of fact, what you have to do is to regularize the vortex current. There are many ways to do it, and the way we found very practical is to consider instead of point, the ring with the conserved vorticity. And the reason why it's very convenient is because the electric field which is created by the cylinder inside the vortex equals to zero. So as a matter of fact, what you feel is only the field which are created by all the other vortices. And therefore it's a way to automatically take care of the self-interaction. And of course, you have to take into account all the non-analyticity and reconstruction I talked about. And this is durable. And so here is the result. Basically this is the action. This is the vortex current, which is regularized by the transmitting delta function into the circle. And the last term is the contribution from the core of each vortex. The last term is just an energy of the core, which is a function of the external bosonic density. This is known. The first part was not known before, and this is just a contribution of the dipole moment I was talking about, that if you differentiate this one with respect to F, you will get the anomalous dipole moment I was talking about previously. So this is the effective action. then you can derive equation of motion. Then the first equation is just a continuity equation for the particles, it's the same. Now, the first Maxwell equation, you have a density vortex, but you also have a contribution for the dipole moment of the vortex, similar to what you have in electrodynamics of the continuous medium. Now, if you have a contribution due to polarization of the vortex to the density, you have to have the contribution due to the vortex density due to the current, due to polarization. And once again, they are connected with each other by the conservation of the vorticity. And you have a contribution to the magnetic moment of the vortex due to the fact. and you have a contribution to the vortex current due to the fact that that the energy of the vortex depends on the effective magnetic field. Now, there are two terms of the magnetization. One of them is due to the current in the core, and the other one is once again due to the Galilean invariance, due to that if you move dipole with a finite velocity, once again, due to the Galilean invariance, you have to have a magnetic moment, which it is. And of course, there is equation of motion due to the vortex, and you will see that now, in addition to what is done before, the kinetic energy appears. This is once again Magnus force, and this is force on the dipoles, on the electric and magnetic dipoles in homogeneous fields. That's more or less all the equations. You can freeze the background and consider the motion of the vortex in the frozen field. What you get as oscillations, and the period of the oscillations is a function of the amplitude of the oscillations. And what is remarkable that due to the non-analytic structure with the decreasing of the amplitude, you can make logarithms as large as possible, so that the frequency of the oscillations in the classical fields, as a matter of fact, with the decreasing of the amplitude going down, and it goes below the boundary, and it goes below the boundary of the phonon spectrum. If so, then you can analyze the lifetime of those oscillations with respect to the radiations of phonons. And it's quite easy to do. The remarkable thing is that what you are getting is omega to the force, which means that as a matter of fact, those oscillations are pretty much long-lived oscillations and it can be considered in the spectrum as an excitations. This I will not be able to explain. This I will skip. And let me just finish with the quantization of the vortex motion. As I said, the result for the lifetime of the oscillations of the vortex with respect to the radiations of phonons is parametrically large, which means that the quantization of the vortex motion is pretty much legitimate procedure. What we did is the semi-classical quantization of the section, the effective action of the vortex. And what you obtain is the following conclusion for the discrete levels. Now, the prefactor is nothing but the boundary of the spectrum. Now, the point is that n0 psi squared for the systems with the large Killing lengths is a large parameter. Now, which means that for some numbers of those levels are once again within the vortex, the spectrum of the vortex. Therefore, they have to be considered pretty much accurately together with the phonon spectrum, provided that n0 psi squared is a large parameter. Okay, so those are my conclusions. I basically try to convince you both by analytics and numerical argument that you, if you solve the structure of the vortex core in the Bose, in two-dimensional Bose system with the large Killing lengths, you will get anomalous dipole moment as a result of the non-analytic reconstruction of the vortex. The leads of the dynamics of the vortex motion much slower than it was previously thought. And therefore, there are some things to do. And one of things will be the effect of those degrees of freedom on the vortex motion disorder potential, which will, I believe, will be considered in the next talk.
Thank you.